Hello, everybody, and welcome to another Tuesday night in the spotlight. Tonight, I have joining me Janice Moffitt, who is a psychic medium, intuitive, spiritual teacher, channeler, and lifelong learner. Growing up in a family that never spoke of mediums, she had no idea why or who she was hearing. Knowing things before they could happen, having incredibly vivid deja vu, there was never fear of what she was seeing or feeling, but always she thought that she would be put away if she mentioned the voices that she was hearing. Most of her life, she has lived the life based on the expectations of others. She went to school to have a career and worked hard. Save your money, buy a house, put away money for a rainy day, for retirement, etc. Work for someone else and allow them to decide your worth. Since math always came with little effort, it was suggested that accounting is where she should venture. So 3 years of post-secondary to a position that was in her field and oh so boring. She started working in the trucking industry before deregulation and learned from the inside how things worked, which led to a 33-year career in logistics, working as an analyst for the last 10 years or so. As 50 was approaching in 2012, it seemed like the need to do something else was calling, and so began the true journey of her heart. Janice mentored with another medium and learned more about mediumship and began seeing clients in 2014. This was part-time work, and she has divided her life between what she knew was where she should be and where she felt she was expected to be. In January of 2017, Janice and her guides met with my guides, and
it's very true.
Yes, I know. I totally just lost my spot on the bio there. And the guides really just did the work to bring the two of us together, and Firefly Mediums was born, where Janice and Catherine do fundraisers, shows, workshops, and now retreats that inspire Janice to do even more. In June 2017, at the age of 55, Janice left the corporate world and dedicated herself full-time to her company, Holy Crow Connections with Spirit. In 2017, she moved from hard work to heart work, and since then, it has been a beautiful journey. So thank you so much, Janice, for joining me here tonight. It's so exciting to have you on.
I know, and you're reading that, and I think, did I write such a long bio? Like, wow, that was a lot for you to say.
It's all good. It is all good.
But, you know, I just kind of wanted to give a bit of a backstory on, you know, this journey, because that's really what I feel compelled to talk about tonight, you know, how sometimes we feel like, well, I've done this for so long now, I guess I'm stuck where I am.
Yeah.
And, yeah, so I'm grateful for this opportunity to come on and, you know, sort of talk about what's going on with me and get a sense of what's, you know, what other people maybe are struggling with, and maybe we can help other people step into heart work.
Awesome. So I would love to hear more about kind of what your experience was, because I know you were starting to get this calling back in 2012, that there was something more to life or for your soul to be experiencing. So how did that process happen that led you into the mediumship?
I guess that I was just, I was starting to feel like really stuck in what I was doing, and wondering like, is this what I came here for? To go to work every day? And, you know, it's not that I really enjoyed some of the people that I worked with, but not all of them. There was a lot of very unhappy people around me. It was very hard. It didn't matter what way you went into work, what your thoughts and energy were. As soon as you got in there, you were just surrounded by people who were not happy because of the work atmosphere, the expectations that were put on people, the corporate life.
Yeah.
Let's call it that. And it was really hard to go to work, and you couldn't look forward to it. And I mean, I could do the work. I could do the work easily. It was, you know, analyzing numbers and pulling stuff together. I could just do it. I did it for 30 plus years. And I just kind of started to wonder, like, is this all I was supposed to do with this life, is just come in here and go and make somebody else a whole lot of money? And then, you know, like the first year I was there, I saved them $6 million.
Wow. So
I wasn't making anywhere near $6 million.
Yeah.
So I started to question, like, what am I supposed to be doing? And then I just thought, I was feeling stressed and I was tired and I wasn't sleeping well. And I thought, okay, I need to start to change my focus here, because this can't be it. So the first thing I did was I decided I was going to learn to meditate, which didn't go so well the first few times. I really did struggle with it. Now I struggle to, if I don't get to meditate on a daily basis. So it's been an interesting process, but by doing that, it sort of led me to more people who were more open to this life, which then made me more curious. And then I started to believe that maybe I belong over here on this side of my brain, because one is very left and one is very right. And I just felt like I felt more at ease in this life than I've ever done. And I mean, I wasn't very pleasant some days. I was tired and angry and cranky. And so now most days I'm not like that. I'm not saying I never have a day like that, but also I think too, when I have one of those moments now, it's a moment and it might be an hour or a couple of hours, and then I move past it and it's all part of what I've learned. And I think that it took me a really long time to start moving into this, because, you know, like you have to have a job. What do you do without a paycheck? And I mean, I'm 3.5 years past leaving that job and people still say to me, like, are you doing okay? I'm like, I'm okay. It just works. And I just feel like I had to lose a lot of stories that I believed. And not that I was, you know, led down the path or anything like that. You know, my parents worked hard for other people and then they retired. My grandparents worked hard for other people, then they retired. My great grandparents. And I mean, I don't think we did without anything, but I don't think we were probably very middle class. I mean, I don't even know. I don't even know where that falls in, but this is what we're taught. You work hard, you get a paycheck, you save your money, you save for what you want, you buy a house, you invest and save, and then you work your ass off, and then you get a few years and then you die.
But it's such a common story that people experience.
Right? And I guess also one day I just kind of wondered, like, well, I probably wondered it more than once, like, who the hell are you to decide my worth? Right? You'd work your ass off and they'd come along and say, oh, yeah, sorry, we just can't be giving one person more than another, even though you contributed more or you did more. So you would be getting like this 1.2% increase along with everybody else who did or did not excel. So there was no motivation to do any more either. And it was, I mean, it's a very corporate thing, right? Because they don't want to run into problems and they don't want someone sitting at this desk making more than someone sitting at this desk. Oh my goodness. So there was nothing to encourage better performance either. And so I think, you know, once I started down the spiritual path, I just couldn't go back. And the last year that I worked in the corporate world was hard for me. I was very focused on building my clientele, building my business, finding a way to make it to a point where I was going to be okay to just walk away.
Yeah.
That was pretty key. And I tell people about the story of my crows when I was still in the corporate world, because this came near the point where I made the decision to hand in my notice. And I was just very frustrated with, I just kept saying that, like, it's destroying my soul to be here. Yeah. soul sucking. It was a soul sucking job. And I mean, and there was lots of good people that I worked with, and I met some great people that I'm still friends with, and I never want to not have those people in my life. But I was driving to work. I was almost there, and I knew what was on the agenda ahead of me and some of the meetings I was going to have to be in. And I just didn't even want to be there. So as I was pulling into the parking lot, I said out loud in my car, and thank God for Bluetooth, because people would be wondering what the hell is with that woman talking to herself in her car. Now they just think I'm on the phone. But I talk out loud a lot in my car. And I said out loud, like, if I am doing everything that I need to be doing to be able to get to a point where I can leave this job, I need to know. Because if there's something else I need to be doing, I want to get moving on it. And I backed my car into parking spot. And as I was getting out of the car, a crow came across the top of the building. And I looked up and I saw it, and it started flying in a circle above me. And I thought, okay, so this is good. This is a sign. And then another one came and another one came until there was nine. So it was nine crows flying in a circle above my head, and they were silent. Wow. And I actually thought I might faint in the parking lot that day, but it was such a good confirmation. And then the crows peeled off, you know, and so this is, I mean, the crow is a big guide for me. And part of the reason why Holy Crow.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so from there, I just sort of decided that I needed to figure this out. The whole going into mediumship, okay. So when I was growing up, nobody talked about mediums. I had no idea what a medium was for a very long time, until in the 80s, when John Edwards had a TV show. And I very clearly remember watching that show in awe. And one day sitting there watching it, and out of my mouth came, well, I could do that. And then I sort of looked around the room to see if anybody noticed that I said it out loud. And nobody really seemed to really notice. But that was really kind of like the first time that I actually sort of knew what was going on.
Yeah.
You know, the ability to I would smell, I would pick up smells, and I would feel, and I would hear these voices, and I didn't know what to do with it. So once I tapped into the whole mediumship thing, and I started to learn how to manage it, it's become amazing. It's become an amazing experience. Ay, ay, ay. Sorry. Did I ramble there?
It's all good.
Sometimes I can talk longer than I realize.
It's all good. Because I think it's important for people to understand that no matter how long you've been at a job, no matter how long you've been comfortable, no matter how many paychecks you have gotten, no matter how close you are to retirement, if it's a soul-sucking job, then it might be a good time to consider to leave and to start following what it is your heart is trying to show you.
Yes. And I mean, when I talk to people about doing that for themselves, I never say, like, don't go and quit your job tomorrow if you haven't started preparing.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, the fact is we are a cash-dependent race, right?
Yeah.
Our civilization is dependent on you having the ability to pay for things, pay for a place to live and food and clothes. And I went to the dentist today and had to pay for the dentist. And so we need to be able to have finances, even to help other people out. You need to have money, right? So I would never encourage somebody to just like walk out on their job if they haven't done work to prepare themselves to do a change. But if there's something really calling it from your heart, then why aren't you taking some kind of steps towards it? I think that if I hadn't done this, I would be beyond miserable. Well, yeah. I'm pretty sure I would be. You know, and when you're that unhappy, you also run into a lot of health issues, and you don't sleep, and you know, and there's so many things that come along with that. So I think it's important for us to know that we don't have to stay just because it's what we know, you know, and sometimes people will even get 3 or 4 or 5 years in and they think, oh, now I have 3 weeks vacation. So I'm just going to stay at this crappy job because I already have 3 weeks vacation.
Yeah.
And honestly, somebody where I worked came to me and asked me for advice because he said, well, you know, they've made some changes and it seems better. And I looked at her and I said, let me tell you this. You can take a stale cupcake and put new icing on the top, but it's still a stale cupcake.
Yeah,
with a little extra frosting. Yep. And so if all of the things that were causing you to consider leaving are still there, but there's a few shiny bits now, what happens when the shiny bits are gone?
Yeah.
All of the stale cupcakes still there. It was a weird analogy, but totally makes sense.
To me.
Yeah. So it really, it could be just moving to a different company. It could be moving to a different career. It could be moving to a different city. It could be just following your heart and going and living off the grid. I mean, whatever it is for you. But I think that, you know, and it's not about people needing to step into spirituality or becoming mediums or anything like that, but it's really about doing something that makes you happy to be there. I mean, when you get up in the morning, you dread going to work, it's time to change something.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if where you're at can't be changed, then you need to change where you're at.
Yeah.
So I think there's a lot of fear around it. And, you know, I say fear and excitement are the same thing, right? Have the same reaction in our body. So yeah. I encourage people to really sit back and give some thought to whether or not is this really fear that's holding you in this position, or or is it the excitement of something new that you're feeling? And sometimes it's just excitement, and sometimes we just need to step into it and be excited for new adventures. Now, younger generations are more inclined to move positions and change jobs and all kinds of stuff, right? They think they will have, I probably average at least 5 years with every job that I had, 5 to 10 years. And I bet some of them have a year, and they're gone. On to something else, on to try something new. And they don't have the same, I don't think they've had the same stigma attached to the whole idea of working and getting what you feel you're worth. I think that there's definitely been a change in mindset around that. But I think that a lot of us are still of the mindset that you go and you get a job and you accept what they're offering you and you accept their terms and conditions and you work within their rules. And then they, when you've given all of your lifeblood, will reward you with a paycheck. Not every place is like that. And some people will work in the same job for 40 years and have loved it every minute of it.
Yep.
I mean, I worked with people where they would come in, they would start at 8 o'clock and at 4 o'clock, they'd be on their way out the door at 4:30 and they would turn off the second they left the building. And when they came in the morning, they'd turn it back on. And if you can do that and you're all right during the day and you don't mind what you're doing, stay where you are.
Absolutely. Now, how do you process, or how did you process moving into what it was that your heart was showing you, or even now, because I know you're doing a lot of this heart-led work, but there's still fears that come up, or there's still blocks that come up. So how do you navigate from your heart and what your mind is showing you, or what those old stories are showing you?
Well, first of all, you got to surround yourself with good people. You need people to support you through this process, because good Lord, if you get people who are afraid to make change for themselves, they will try to convince you to stay where you are.
Yeah.
So you need people who've been through it, or who are living it, or who understand some of the processes that happen to you as you move through it. and learning, a lot of learning goes on, and when you have to self-reflect and really get real about what it is you want. And, you know, one of the first things I started doing after learning to meditate was started journaling.
Yeah.
And it's very simple, but it's also a very effective way to sort of bring your thoughts out of your head onto paper. And then you kind of go, wonder what that means. Or you go, now that's really clear. I was doing those group readings, and then I heard about the group reading that was going to happen there with this medium. And I'm going to mention names. It was Mark from the Olive Readers, and it was his earlier days. And it was I remember him walking in the room, and I remember thinking, do I know you from somewhere? Turns out we have a couple past lives together, but And this is when I kind of realized that I could in fact really do this, because he started working around the room. And all of a sudden I had this huge pain in my head. And I thought, oh my God, I'm having an aneurysm. I am going to die right here in this room right now. I couldn't even look up, and I couldn't open my eyes, and it was so painful. And I thought, oh my God, what's going on? And I could still hear him talking, and I hear him say to the woman, like, that's directly across the room from me, saying, who's the man with the tumors in her head? And she said, that's my father. And as soon as she acknowledged the father, the pain went out of my head. And I sat up and I sort of looked around the room, and I went, what just happened? And so I don't know if he knows this or not, but I sort of worked around the room with him that night. And then he got to me, and I went, me? Are you talking to me? And he like got on the floor on his knees and elbows, and he said, this is going to take a long time, isn't it? And I don't even remember what all he said to me that night, but I did have someone come up to me like a year later saying, oh, I remember you that night. He was so mean to you. I said, whatever he said, I don't remember, but I do know that I mentored with him, and he was awesome. He was awesome. He taught me so much. It was ridiculous. And he actually believed in me long before I did, which was really cool. So I started mentoring with him, and I did a weekend of mentorship a few months later, and then I started taking these classes with him, and it was absolutely incredible. And then I could see a new possibility once I was able to feel like I could actually do this for other people and not just for myself. It became such a big desire, and I almost needed to do it. And I don't think I could have stepped back from it at that point.
Yeah.
And I think seriously, one of the turning points for me was in 2013. My father was in the hospital up in Sault Ste. Marie 7 years ago. And I flew up because I hate the drive. I hate the long drive.
Yep.
It's a 45-minute plane flight from Toronto to Sault Ste. Marie. So my brother lived in Sault Ste. Marie, and so my father was in the hospital there. And I flew up for a 3-day weekend to visit him in the hospital. And I saw him on the Friday, and he knew who I was, and I saw him on the Saturday, and then I saw him on the Sunday just before I left, and he wasn't sure who I was, and I told him, I've got to go home because I got to work tomorrow, and he asked me where I worked. I told him, he said, oh, do you know Janice? And I just put it down to really good drugs for pain, I think, at that point. And I went back to my brother's house to get my stuff to go to the airport, and I was outside, and I was a smoker at that time, so I was having a smoke. And I remember standing in the driveway, and I might have said it out loud, that's the last time I'll see my dad alive. And I thought, where the hell did that come from? And a week later, he was gone. Even though he had been doing so much better than he had been the last time I had seen him.
Yeah.
I knew. They showed it to me. So that was kind of like also a a push point for me.
Absolutely. This.
So it was, there was lots of clues. Let's call them clues. Slaps upside the head.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Awesome. And I mean, I'm a part of your journey at this point. So I know a lot of the stuff that you're doing, the stuff that you're working on. And you just revealed something last week or 2 weeks ago. I don't even know. I think I got my order in last week. So can you tell us a bit about that?
Sure. So part of the things that happens for me is, you know, I get these downloads. I get downloads. And if you follow me at all, either on Facebook or Instagram or both, you will see, and I haven't had as many in the last couple of months as I used to get, but every day I would get a new download and I would go and I would post up this little blurb or quote or inspirational saying up on Instagram and share it to Facebook. And sometimes they would give me these incredibly deep thoughts, and I'm just like the messenger of it. And then a couple of years ago, I decided that I should put it together in a book or a set of cards or something. And it rolled around and rolled around. And then I got a download for an Oracle deck. And I've been fighting to try to get that done. And I just kept getting stalled. And then a few weeks ago, suddenly I just got like this slap that you haven't done the other deck yet. So I sat down and in 2.5 days, I picked all of my favorites. And I've created a deck. This is my proof deck, and I'm going to be doing pre-orders till Sunday on this deck. So it's 70, there's 78 cards, but one is the story of the deck. And there they are.
Awesome.
And so they're just, it's just a nice little deck, 77 cards. And I call them cards of inspiration, insight, and reflection. So you could pull a card a day. You just sort of go into the deck and you just pull a card and let's see what we get. So this one is, talking the talk means little if you don't walk the walk. Make sure your actions match your words. And so, I mean, that's just what came to me that day and I wrote it. So there's all kinds of these quotes that have been given to me from Spirit. So I'm pre-selling this deck.
And the website for that is?
It's www.holycrowconnections.com.
I'm just going to get that into the comment section here. Holycrowconnections.com.
Yes. So I'm excited by that. I've got lots of people who have who've been pre-ordering them. And so I'm going to hold the pre-orders until Sunday night at midnight. Basically Monday, I'm going to place an order for them. They're selling for $40, but I'm doing a special price for a pre-order. If you pre-order, they're $36, so 10% off, and then they'll be in second to third week of October, and then I'll be either making arrangements to do drop-offs, pickups, or I'll putting them in the mail. So wherever you are, I can mail them to you. So I'm pretty excited about that. I'm working on the Oracle deck, which is going to be really cool when I finished. I was working on it today and then I heard I should go live. So I went and did a live on my Facebook page for an hour, 51 minutes and 11 seconds, 5111. Right. I don't know why I showed that, but anyways, I said at the beginning of it, I'm going to be here for 15 or 20 minutes, and 51 minutes later, stopping off with it. But it was good. I had fun. So, I mean, the decks, one thing we've been working on, all kinds of workshops, you know, took me a while to step into doing the workshops, but I really love doing them. The first year or so I was like, well, who wants to learn anything from me? But now I just enjoy talking about this stuff so much that I'm happy to share and teach and spread my understanding of how things work with other people. So I got some workshops on the go right now. Everything's on Zoom for workshops. Took me a year to find the space to be able to have a space to do these workshops. And then a few months after I found it, then we came into this situation. So now everything's online. And it's just, And something that I really am excited about is I am delving into forensic mediumship.
Yes. Yes. So tell us more about that.
Well, you know, I've always had a pull towards missing people. So when something pops up that somebody's missing, or there's something unsolved, or people are, I will actually spend time connecting to try to come up with stuff, and then I'll sort of sit back and hold it and then see if I was right. I don't know why I do that. You know, I think it's because I don't want to give people the wrong information. And as I've done this over a couple of years and been able to come up with very clear information, but then I still have the whole, how do you go to the police and say, this is what I saw?
Yeah.
Right. So like there was a missing woman, and the granddaughter was posting stuff, and I clearly saw some stuff, and I sent her a message, and then I thought, oh, maybe you shouldn't have done that. So I deleted it, but then she could see that I sent her a message. So then I just sent her something very fluffy. But it turns out that everything I said, including like she'll be home Thursday, was true. And so I got to stop questioning myself on that. But I do need to learn how to best relay that information, you know, either through the police or through some other source. So that's part of what I'm in the process of learning. I'm taking a workshop in October, which I'm excited for. And I just really would like to be able to help bring people home.
Yeah.
And I got to the top of the stairs last night and heard the Amber Alert on my phone downstairs. And I thought, oh, do I need to go down and look at it? And then I saw a little girl with dark hair, and I thought it was a doll, but I guess there was a second child. And then I got, they're okay. And I got up in the morning, and like within an hour, they had been found.
Yeah.
So I knew I didn't need to do anything with that one. But so I'm really looking forward to getting more involved in that. I think that, well, you know, I have a cousin who was abducted and has never been found, and I know what that does to a family, having that unfinished story, right? So I think I'm pretty sure that's a motivator for me to move into this as well.
Yeah,
and the other thing that's pulling at my ear is, and I don't even know where I'm going with this yet, but I really feel this call to do something with healing through grief. And I'm not sure how that's going to play out yet, but I'm going to work on it because I really feel like that's an important thing too.
Absolutely. And I love that about you, is a lot of times you're like, I have no idea how I'm going to do this. I have no idea what this is supposed to look like, but this is what I'm getting. And then you just start running with it. And it's almost like planting the seeds and then waiting to see what grows from it.
Right.
Which is beautiful. Now, I don't know if you can answer this. Sarah's just asked, I know it's potentially silly, but how did they communicate the info on the TV show Medium?
So you mean like the Long Island Medium or something like that?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure what show she's talking about. So I was hoping that you would know. That's why I said, I don't know if you'll be able to answer this.
So, well, listen, the people that are on those shows are actual mediums. And I don't have to be sitting with the person in order to connect to them and get information. Neither do you. You know, we do a lot of things through video and phone, and I can get messages just the same. It's like when I'm connecting to that woman who went missing and seeing where she's at and seeing what's around her, So the thing that I want to say about the TV shows is they are edited. And so you're only getting the best bits and you're not getting the struggle for the words and you're not getting the get away from me if you walk up to somebody kind of thing. Because that's, for me, that's one thing that I don't do. So
So Sarah's going on to say it was a show with Patricia Arquette. It wasn't a real show, but she worked with the authorities is what the show was.
I do remember that show and I used to watch it now that you say it.
Okay.
Patricia Arquette is actually plays a woman. She's the role she's playing is of a medium who is an actual medium.
Okay.
It's the woman's actual story. And how it affected her family. Now, the things I didn't like about that show is sometimes they had demonistic spirits connected where they would create havoc and stuff. And I don't allow them any of that to come through for me. So, but that show is based on a woman who actually did work with the police.
Oh, okay.
So though I think there's a lot of fact-based information in that show, but of course it's been built for Hollywood glamour, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, it's interesting to see how people are portrayed, and you know they're. There you'll see the people who always say, oh, seeing a medium is just a waste of your money, just hand me your money, I'll tell you your future. Well, I'm not a fortune teller and I only can tell you what I am shown, and if you want to know, you have to give me your permission. And people will say, oh, if they were really good they would know you were looking for them. And I my response to that is
some conversations about this.
Right? My response has always been a good psychic would not have the morals that were so unethical that they would be connecting to you without permission to know that you were wanting them. Yeah. And so as someone with ethics and morals, I would never connect to your energy without your permission. Yeah. So there's no way I would know that you wanted to see me.
Yeah.
Even when I do a live, just because somebody has made a comment on my post, I do not pull a card for you unless you specifically say to me, I would like a card.
Yeah.
I'm not doing it. I won't do it because for me, that's permission.
It's part of. Are you still there, Janice?
I am still here. Can you see me now? No, you froze. There you go.
I can. Now you're... Your head was moving really fast there for a second. They caught up. We went into a time warp and then we came back together.
There we go. Yeah. So I mean, it's when I teach intuition and psychic development classes, the very first thing that we talk about is having permission.
Yeah.
And if you don't have permission, don't do it. That's just my personal take on it. I mean, after you leave one of my classes, I have no control over what you do or don't do.
Yep.
That is always my advice.
Awesome.
I know.
So, sorry. Go ahead.
Go ahead. No. What's your question?
So I was going to ask more about, because the topic is about following your heart no matter the age. So yeah. What advice would you give to people who are feeling stuck or feeling as though, and I mean, I'm going to list off all of the excuses that we use here. So feeling as though they're too old, too young, too broke, too comfortable in the job that they're in. They have kids, they don't have kids yet. They want to... Whatever the case might be.
I don't have the education. I don't have the time. I don't have the money. I have responsibilities. I have people depending on me. I can't learn something new now. What if I fail? What if you succeed? What if you succeed? What if you become the best version of you and all the people around you become better for it? What if you inspire your children to do what they desire as opposed to what they feel is expected of them? Like, it to me, it was so empowering to be able to step into this. And sure, I was scared. I'm like, Janice, like, seriously, you're 50 years old. What the hell are you doing? And then when I decided to leave my job, I was 55. And I'm like, you have like 10 years and you're done. Why don't you? And I couldn't face it.
Yeah.
I gave my notice. I gave 4 weeks notice. I ended up staying 10 because they had to replace me. But it was scary. Sure it was, because I had to step away from what I knew. And then when you constantly have people questioning, are you doing okay? Are you doing okay? How are you doing that without a paycheck? I'm like, because I believe in it. Yeah. I now believe in what I'm doing. I now believe that what I do helps people. And it's, yes, I get paid for my God-given gift. But so does every teacher, every musician, every football player, every doctor, yep, every lawyer, every scientist are getting paid for their God-given gifts, their special abilities. And so I don't feel bad about getting paid for mine now that I've stepped into this gift.
Awesome.
And I've had days where I question my worth, right? Because you'll get a whole bunch of negative feedback from somebody about something that's really like not even relevant to you. But you kind of go, what? And then, you know, you stay there for 2.5 minutes and then you step back out of it. But there was one day, I think I had 3 different people use that. How can you charge for God-given gifts? And God wouldn't be happy that you're charging people. And I'm like, what? Do you do your job for free? No, this is a cash society, man. We got to get paid for what we do. And I have seen people change their entire life. Sometimes it's absolutely incredible. And I'm not saying that from a place of ego. I'm saying that from a place of heart. When you're able to help somebody step through to the next level of grief, because that's really what it is, to be able to move to a different perspective or a different level of functioning, because some people become almost unable to function if they get stuck in grief, and understandably so. I mean, there is a lot of stages of grief, and we've not really been taught how to move through grief. And that, I think that's probably why that healing through grief keeps coming up for me. And when you're able to help somebody through or to understand something that happened, or to hear a message that sort of gives them relief around the loss of a loved one, that sort of shifts their whole energetic being. And then they're able to sort of, it's almost like they're able to jump back into life. That is huge for me. And I some days I just sit in awe, because I mean, all I am is the conduit. I'm not actually doing anything except being the way the messages come.
Yeah.
And I'm just so very grateful to be able to do it.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to go back to what other people's expectations are, or thoughts or beliefs, because I believe as a society, we do tell people what we think is just best for them. I know for myself, especially when Odin was starting school, a lot of people started saying, oh, so are you going to get a real job now? And I was like, I'm putting in like 60 plus hours a week right now. Like, what kind of real job do you want me to get? Because I don't really know one that's going to work around this schedule with kids and stuff. So I find it always very interesting, because what other people tell us can either be the driving force to help us get to that next level, or it can be the stopping force that stops us from actually
right
moving forward.
Well, you got to have a paycheck, and you got to have benefits, man, because like things come up and you got to be able to pay for them. And what about a pension? You got to have a pension. You know, I put all this money away into RSPs. I still have it, but I put all this money away into RSPs with the idea that, okay, I'm going to work really hard now. And then when I hit 65, suddenly magically, I don't need to work anymore. And I'm going to live off of all this money that I've been putting away. And at 55, I, you know, walked away from that idea. When we hit March and everything came to a screeching halt, I spent a day in panic because everything, I was booked out months and everything just went cancel, 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 cancel. Every show, every event, every booking, everything just canceled. And I'm like, okay, now what are you going to do? Because yeah. I have a mortgage and I have rent on my place. And I had this panic. And then I thought, wait a minute, Janice, you put all this money away for when you weren't working. Why are you being caught up in this story of 65, 65, 60? Like, this is your money. So I mean, I had to simply step back and go, stop it. Stop talking about this as if it's going to be like the end of you. You just have to change your thought around when you get to take that. It's yours. It's not written in stone that you have to wait till you're 65.
Yeah.
It's income for when you're done working. Well, I'm not done working, but at the time it made perfect sense. So suddenly I was able to breathe again, and then I was able to refocus, and then we switched to the whole online thing, and you know, things got better. But it that's one of the things. We feel like if we don't have somebody telling us what we're worth and giving us a check and covering off the dentist, and oh, I'll never be able to go to the dentist. I go for a massage every 3 weeks. I go to the dentist I was going every 4 months for cleanings because I get calculus on my teeth and it just keeps my
calculus. Teeth
calculus.
Is that really what it's called?
Yes.
Oh. Okay. I didn't realize that was a term, and I thought, anyways, okay. So you got calculus building up on your teeth. Yep. Yeah.
So anyways, I would go every 4 months to get it cleaned off. Now it's been 8 months, but I went today and it's so nice to have my teeth cleaned.
Yeah.
I pay, but I gain so much more by not being stuck in that soul sucking job where my potential for earning is completely limited by how much they're willing to pay me and what their the value they put on what I'm contributing to their company. And honestly, I think I'm worth a whole lot more than they used to pay me. I saved them $6 million in a year.
Yeah. And I think sometimes we confuse our worth with the money that we're making or not making. And even in business and stuff, there's a lot of people that will say to you, you got to make sure you're charging what you're worth. Well, you actually can't put a price on any of us.
Right.
We are all completely priceless. So whenever we put a monetary value of our worth on the work that we're doing, on what our output is, on whether or not we're getting results or saving the company $6 million or whatever the case might be, it's our worth is so much more than that. We are time and space and energy all combined into this one physical unit that we are. How do you put a money on that? How do you put any value on that? It's completely priceless, you know?
And the other thing where, when I worked there, if I worked 20 extra hours in a week, they didn't mind at all. They didn't give me anything extra for it. But if I needed an extra half an hour for a dentist appointment, I either had to make it up that day or use vacation time. I'm like,
Yeah.
Okay. So there was always this imbalance, right? And and now if I want a Monday off, I just don't book anybody in.
Yeah.
And one of the best gifts that I've gotten out of this is I don't set an alarm clock unless I absolutely have to be up.
Yeah.
Most days I don't have to be up. And I'm not sleeping till noon, but I'm probably sleeping till 7. And I'm waking up as opposed to being woke up.
Yeah.
So you're waking up naturally and not being jarred awake to the world. And that is like the best gift I gave myself. And I don't know, I just wish more people could understand how absolutely glorious this life can be when we take control of what we're giving our time and energy to. And how very different my life is now versus when I was making a living working for somebody else. And I put that in air quotes, absolutely, because it's not making a living. It's taking home a paycheck.
Yeah.
And hey, and I'm saying this, if you're happy to do that, that is fine. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it if you're fine with it. And there are a lot of people very content with doing that.
Absolutely.
But if you're feeling like there's got to be more to life, or you're not happy with what you're doing, and you think that if you're too late, you're too committed, you're too far in, you're too short, you're too tall, you're too young, you don't have enough money, you have too much debt, you don't have debt, but you don't want to risk, whatever your reasons are.
It's interesting. Always come up with a reason not to do something.
Right?
And it's usually the reason that we say, I can't do it because of.
Oh, it's Tuesday.
That's the exact reason that we should be doing it.
Right?
I can't because of kids. Well, no, do it because
you have kids. Right?
Well, I can't because I don't have money. Well, do it so you can make some money.
Exactly. Exactly. And I mean, this is all things that we've learned over time. And I mean, how do you find your way through that? Well, here's a good throw in. We are doing a retreat, a weekend retreat, specifically on this, but and we're gonna help people find their way through it.
Yes.
Because we are both working from our hearts now, and we have learned the lessons, and we have done the work, because you have to do the work to move through a lot of shit sometimes, to be able to get yourself into a place where you have a better understanding of who you are and what you want, and being confident enough to step into it, and maybe being so scared that you have to be pushed into it a little bit, but knowing that it's the right thing for you, and how to support yourself when you're going through all of these crazy thoughts in your head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I think for a lot of people, it's just having someone to not necessarily hold your hand, but someone to see you in that vulnerability, someone to hold that space for you, where it's okay for you to be fearful. It's okay for you to feel stuck in that moment. And yet they're going to help you get out of that moment.
Remind you of all the beautiful things on the other side of that moment.
Yeah. Because a lot of times we can see each other in a much better spotlight than what we're able to see ourselves. And sometimes we need someone to reflect back to us. Hey, this is where your amazingness is.
Yeah. And absolutely. And I mean, I think that like you've supported me through a lot of stuff since we've met. And
you know,
our guides sure knew what they were doing when they brought us together. Honest to God, it's been absolutely incredible. And I tell you, we have had some of the best times. Sometimes we get pretty silly, just saying. But we've also had some of the most amazing experiences, you know. When we're teaching people, or when we're doing group events, and you know, like how excited do we get when we talk about this retreat we're doing next spring, right? We can't talk about it without smiling, because we're both so excited about the potential for people to step into this incredible experience of their life. And a lot of people will feel that they're not actually living their own life because they've always done, you know, what they were taught when they grew up and what the expectation is based on what they saw on TV or read in a book or saw at the supermarket or learned in school, whatever it was that put these ideas in our head of how things are supposed to be. And nobody said, these are just suggestions.
Yeah.
Became this expectation that this is how your life is going to play out.
Exactly.
We're here to say that's not the case. It's your decision. So,
yes. So join us at the Heart Speak Retreat, April 30th to May 2nd, 2020 or 2021. Wow. I can't say it. 2021. There we go. Keep getting stuck on 2020. So one last question for you before we wrap this up.
Oh, I was supposed to plan this too.
You wanted to plan it, but
I totally forgot.
He was like, no one else gets to plan it, so you don't get to plan it either. So if you could give the world one piece of advice right now, what would you want the world to know?
Okay. I'm going to try to be careful with my words. I want people to listen to their gut and listen to their heart. And because what we see, what we hear, what we experience is not always the truth. And that's part of the whole expectation thing. You know, we expect teachers to teach us the right things, but they're teaching you from their experience. We expect doctors to give us the best advice. We expect our parents will have taught us all we need to know. We expect that our kids will listen to us and follow in our footsteps. And we, you know, I don't have kids. I'm making that up.
I'm thinking, I do not expect my kids to listen at all. If they do, it's like, woohoo.
where we create this false expectation. And sometimes, you know, if something isn't sitting right with you, I want you to take a moment and go, what about this doesn't feel right for me? And what does my heart say about it? Because I think this is really where we need to start shifting our attention and listening to our gut the news is a business. And I really think, I haven't watched the news in years. And every once in a while, you know, I pick up little bits and pieces off of Facebook or Twitter or whatever, and you get little glimpses of stuff that's going on. And it's not that I don't have an understanding of what's going on in the world. However, there's a whole lot of stuff that I have no control over. And I just sort of let that go. So take everything that you're seeing and run it through your filter and make sure that it's truthful for you. And if it feels truthful for you, fine. That's great. And if somebody else doesn't have the same opinion, it doesn't mean they're wrong. It means they have a different opinion. They have a different perception. They have a different point of view. It's like if they expected you to agree with everything they said, you wouldn't necessarily want to do that. So let's be respectful of differing opinions. Let's use our heart and our intuition to filter for what feels right for us. And we don't have to have big arguments about things. We can just have different opinions. How about we just say that?
Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Thank you so much for joining me tonight, Janice. I really enjoyed our conversation as always.
Thanks for having me on.
Anytime.
I love to talk. Can you tell?
I know you do. It's all good.
I know. We're almost at an hour. I know you got to cut it off.
Yeah. So if anybody's wanting to order her new deck, Here's a Thought. It is available at www.holycrowconnections.com. We also have the Heart Speak Retreat coming up April 30th to May 2nd of 2021. And that's available at fireflymediums.com. And if you guys are wanting to connect with Janice, her Facebook page is Holy Crow Connections with Spirit. And thank you everyone who joined in on the conversation tonight, who joined in to listen. Next Tuesday, I have Siva Ram Spronk coming on, and she's going to be talking to us about the healing powers of meditation and breathwork. So it's going to be a really interesting conversation to have. I hope you'll join us.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody.
Have a great night.